I'd like to thank everyone for coming to this Mixed Methods webinar series put on by the Mixed Methods International Research Association, as well as University of Alberta's International Institute for Qualitative Methodology. This will be our last webinar for 2017, but please check out our website. We'll hopefully have the 2018 schedule posted soon. By Dr. Cheryl Poth. Dr. Cheryl Poth is a faculty member in the Center for Research and Applied Measurement and Evaluation, Department of Educational Psychology at the University of Alberta, Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. In this role, she has developed and teaches graduate courses in research methods and program evaluation. Dr. Poth is an adjunct appointment in the Faculty of Medicine and Dentistry and serves as a methodologist on several cross-disciplinary research teams. Dr. Poth's specific research interests include enhancing research quality and collaborative research teams in the field of education and the health sciences. She is an advisory board member of the International Institute for Qualitative Methodology and fourth president of the Mixed Methods International Research Association. She currently serves as associate editor of the Journal of Mixed Methods Research and editorial board member of the International Journal of Qualitative Methodology and Canadian Journal of Program Evaluation. She co-authored with John Cresswell on the fourth edition of the Qualitative Inquiry and Research Design 2017 and is working on a mixed methods research book. Cheryl, we're very happy to have you here with us today, and you can go ahead and get started.
Great. Well, hello. I am really happy to have this short time with you this afternoon to explore some of the dilemmas and opportunities within complex mixed methods research that have occupied my brain over the past few years. First, you must be wondering, who is the voice? And do I have the control here, Yvette, or do you?
You can go ahead.
Okay, so I can go ahead and move the arrows. Thank you. You must be wondering, so who I am. So here is where I'm located in Canada, and where is the University of Alberta specifically? Oh, there's always a couple of funny things that happen when you change slides over. And then what does it currently look like outside of my window? Well, this is what it, winter has come. We had about 5 centimeters of snow last night. And so if you're in a warm climate right now, I am envious. That is November in Alberta. So here is some of my research and ongoing mixed methods works across different areas. Some of the work that's been completed, if you're interested. I've been working as a mixed methods researcher since forever, but I've been connected to the global mixed methods research community since my first workshop with John Cresswell back in 2003. Some of this interest then led me to develop this mixed methods course on campus, and I actually wrote about this in 2014 about what it looks like. I also have done some work in teams, which was exploring the role of the mixed methods practitioner across. I'm also very interested in quality. Tony Ongwen-Buzi and I did 2 issues focused on mixed methods research in the International Journal of Qualitative Methods, which is open access if you're interested. And then I have some work that's in progress around complexity in mixed methods research, one of the things we're here to talk about now. There is a forthcoming relaunch of this journal, and the inaugural issue was invited, and there's some great people involved, and I was very fortunate to be invited. So have a look at that. This is the book that's currently in the process of copy editing, and it's around innovations and mixed methods, and it's around talking about what we're talking about today as well. I'm also interested in mixed methods and learning environments, and so right now I've got a couple of articles around that and some of my other work. So hopefully what has happened here is that I've established a little bit of credibility. I am also, as Yvette kindly mentioned, serving as president of the Mixed Methods International Research Association. What was really important in my development as a mixed methods researcher was seeing the same folks bridge my disciplines and thus become mentors. In my case, as an educational researcher and program evaluator, the people like Donna Mertens, Burke Johnson, and Jennifer Green were important influences in addition to my own doctoral supervisor, Lynn Shula from Queen's University. So if you haven't already been able to find some folks who you can rely on and you can talk to about mixed methods, please do so and find the folks who can become those mentors to you. What I'd like to do now is to set the stage for this webinar as a place for you to consider the usefulness of my ideas to your own work. That is because you should see this webinar as a place to create your journey about complexity. This is essential because the connections you make with the webinar content today is personal to your experiences. The readiness you possess to consider complexity is individualized. No two people are the same. And the agreement you voice about the ideas I advance may be low or high, somewhere in between. Differences are to be expected and welcomed because this creates a richer conversation. And the consideration you give to the webinar content presents an opportunity for shifting your perspectives of the world. For many, this is a paradigm shift and can take time, so be patient. Obviously, we should have looked at this event because a few things are changed, I guess, between the Mac and the, because we've actually lost one of my lines here, which said, the feedback you offer is necessary to move us all forward in our thinking. So please feel free to be in touch, and my email contact is on the front slide. So as we go forward, there are certain ideas that I will talk about to create the space for a discussion around complexity and complex mixed methods research. So I will begin with defining what I mean by complexity and complex mixed methods research, and I will introduce one of the acronyms you will see throughout, which is MMR. You can see that on your screen. I will offer some of my personal experiences with complexity and how my thinking is evolving and continues to evolve because of the dilemmas I have seen and opportunities I imagine that have brought me to focus on complexity and mixed methods research. Then together, we can advance some ideas for how innovations can be developed and opportunities seized within the field of mixed methods practice. So a great place for us to start is to recognize that all research is complex, but the ability to recognize the complexity and its potential sources rests squarely on the shoulders of the researcher. This is because recognizing complexity is important because of the impacts it has on your research decisions. If you seek to recognize sources of complexity in your mixed methods research, then you are more likely to design procedures that will help you capture it and thus be able to tackle mixed methods research problems. Now, the next question is what exactly is complex mixed methods? So you may be familiar with some of the terms that have been advanced in the literature to describe varying situations under which research and evaluation can take place. Some people prefer simple, complicated, and complex. Because I disagree that any conditions can be considered simple, I prefer instead to describe how one frames the conditions as low complexity, moderately complex, and high complexity. In the literature, simple is a term used to describe situations where one in which knowledge and experience tell you what to do and there is widespread agreement about what to do. If a researcher frames a mixed method study as having low complexity, then the purposes are assumed to be known and the characteristics of predictability and agreement about the procedures permits detailed planning and implementation. Examples of low complexity research problems have established practices for attaining the predictable outcome, such as to distinguish among low and high ability readers. So to do that, you might rely on a standardized instrument and designs. In so doing, these procedures could be used again with a different population with predictable results. And that we know here who would need to be involved. So you'd be able to identify, let's say, a quantitative person and a qualitative person. You knew exactly what their roles were going to be. And so that's something that's more low complexity. Sounds familiar, because that's how many of our training programs are set up to prepare people for more low complex studies. Complicated has been a term used to describe situations that are less predictable and whose outcomes and procedures for attaining the outcomes are less certain, but still able to be known. That's an important difference. If a researcher frames a mixed methods research study as moderately complex, then the problem often dictates that more than one area of expertise is needed, and therefore these must be coordinated and integrated. Examples of moderately complex research problems have best approaches for attaining the knowable outcomes, such as, let's say, teaching someone to swim. One might integrate across different teaching methods and disciplines to reach slightly different outcomes. But yet, in so doing, these procedures could be adapted to different populations with somewhat predictable results. And also, those involved would also be somewhat predictable. Complex, then, is a term to describe situations characterized by unpredictable outcomes and high uncertainty and high social conflict. So many factors and variables are interacting. Many of them are not only unknown, but unknowable. If a researcher frames a mixed method study as highly complex, then the problem often research involves more creative practices to respond to emerging conditions. Examples of high complexity research problems have been innovative approaches for tackling homelessness or poverty, because there are so many social and health factors that may be interacting with other factors that we have yet to understand. In so doing, these procedures will be vastly different each time with unknown, knowable results. And we actually don't know who to bring together in order to be able to tackle these problems. While the terms simple, complicated, and complex have been helpful in beginning to distinguish situations under which research and evaluation occur, I find that they have limited usefulness. This is because if you're like me, having studied measurement error then in standardized assessments, where we spent our adolescence teaching kids to swim, or worked on social innovations for addressing poverty, you may also recognize that these examples of problems are simply different degrees of complex situations. Because I now consider all research to occur under conditions of complexity, my evolving understanding are the basis for my use of low, moderate, and high complexity to describe the varying mixed methods research conditions. In my upcoming book, I'm describing a tool that can be used to help distinguish between these three different types. I'm calling it a complexity study profile, because I think what you want to do at the beginning is you actually want to begin to identify which parts of your study are more complex than others, because it does help you. So to what extent do you embrace complexity and mixed methods research at this time? As you know, doing a webinar is very strange because you're talking one way at this time. But if you can, if you have a piece of paper in front of you and a pencil, let's see if you can jot down a couple of things. Take a minute and think about a mixed methods research study that you've undertaken or you are interested in undertaking. If you've got one in mind, consider now, how did you choose to see the conditions of complexity for the research? And let me help you. Can you think about it in ways of the research purpose, the context, the contributors, procedures, and outcomes? I'm just going to give you a second here, so I'll stop talking for about 15 seconds. Now consider if you saw these aspects as less or more complex. Interestingly, you probably saw that some aspects were less complex and some were more complex. And so that's what happens, in my opinion, across many of our studies, is that the context for some may be very complex, whereas the people needed or the contributors might be less complex, or the opposite. So why do you think you framed your study in this way? You are framing, perhaps, the study in this way. Is it because of the lens in which you're choosing to see, the focus in which you're giving, or your audience member, perhaps? So there are lots of things that can influence the way that you're seeing the complexity in your study. I have to tell you that sometimes complexity can be overpowering. And you actually do have to reduce the complexity in some ways or to focus your research in a way so you can actually undertake it. Let me tell you a little bit about how I came to embrace complexity. Strangely enough, it has to do with baking of banana bread. So I came to thinking about complexity through my own life experiences. A metaphor advanced by Zimmerman and Globerman in 2004 for characterizing a simple problem of how to bake a cake effectively illustrates the value as well as my concern with promoting established mixed methods research practices without first considering the research conditions in which you're working. Whereas a good cake recipe provides adequate guidance under many conditions we may have encountered, I can tell you about the baking challenges I experienced when I first arrived in 1996 to live in Quito, Ecuador, in South America, which is situated at a high elevation, happens to be close to 3,000 meters or just over 9,000 feet. Despite having initially experienced lightheadedness from the elevation in my first few years, I never considered that my new baking conditions would affect my tried and tested banana bread recipe. Now, if those of you who have ever tried to bake at different altitudes, you can laugh at my results, because of course it resulted in an inedible connotation that was flattened in appearance and tasted distinctively of baking soda. In my case, rather than recognizing the changing conditions between going from living in Toronto at sea level to living at 10,000 feet or 3,000 meters, I applied what worked previously without thinking about the changing conditions. Now, when I adapted my approach to the baking soda and looked up that I needed to add in an extra egg, I had much better results. I could not help but begin to think similarly about my mixed methods work as I began to experience challenges. There is my picture of being at high elevation as well. So I began to think similarly, that is, more complexitively sensitive thinking to the challenges I was hearing about. After hearing many accounts reflective of what initially appeared to be diverse challenges over the past decade, I mapped the similarities among these accounts onto my own experiences as a researcher. And as I mentioned, I came up with kind of five patterns. It affected the research conditions in such a way that the viability of the study was threatened and the outcomes of the dilemma depended upon how I would respond. And this is what I mentioned before, that it's not uncommon that researchers are not prepared for working under conditions that are more complex, because much of our methodological training has the assumption of stability to address research problems. And so responding appropriately requires some sort of sensitivities. So I began thinking about these, and specifically, let's talk about the five areas or patterns that I saw. So the one I saw was, somebody once told me, I cannot research this problem because it has not been studied before and no literature exists to guide me. Well, this was a problem in terms of how to define mixed methods research problems. And so what I did here is that I talk about here then what research phase, what the researcher tasks, the desirable outcomes, and the dilemmas posed. And so this is a similar setup for the next other four patterns as well. So in the defining programs, what the researcher is supposed to do anyways, is to consider the experiences, motivations, and literature when you're exploring the foundational study ideas, and to figure out, you know, who has done this work before, how did they do it? Well, what you want to do out of this work is you want to be able to articulate the research problem, and usually we describe it by the topics, the purposes, and the questions, and that this then informs the designs. Well, what happens then when you can no longer pinpoint the study need or the integration need or the purpose for doing the research when you don't understand about the topic? So think about poverty, think about homelessness. We don't have a good understanding. We might have some in different aspects, but what you actually have to do is you have to make the case for doing and defining this problem based on incomplete understandings. Well, many people have told us that this isn't a strong enough way of being able to do it. So this was certainly a dilemma that I heard lots about. And this was keeping people from being able to do this. And so I wanted to kind of help them find a workaround. The next pattern I saw was somebody told me, I cannot do this research because I do not yet understand the contextual boundaries of my study. So maybe I don't understand how the local context, let's say, of a research that was about legal practice. Let's say I didn't understand about the history or about the societal influences. So in this case, what you normally want to do is you want to consider the context. And what you want to be able to produce is a description of the research location or research context that talks about the societal, the local, and the personal context that all kind of work together. But the dilemma here was that if we don't know, or that we don't know where to place those boundaries, then it's really hard to actually describe where this complex research is taking place. The third pattern that I heard about and that I saw was people telling me that, for example, my supervisor tells me I need to use a sequential mixed method design, or that I want to do this, and it does not fit with what I want to do in my study. I've also heard a lot about trying to fit their study into a particular design. Well, this is problematic because what you want to do when you're describing designs is that you want to communicate the research design by describing the data procedures that answer the research questions, and particularly mixed methods, you want to talk about where the integration takes place. Well, what happens if there's no design in order for you to, let's say, in the typologies or in the labels? So what you need to do then is do something very different, is you want to be able to describe what you want to do, the design and the procedures, and not feel fixed by those design typologies. So by design typologies, I'm talking about, many people know John Cresswell's work, where, you know, even though his new book has changed a little bit, but he talks about sequential explanatory designs. Also, Tashikori and Headley have, you know, 32 other typologies. So typologies, there's lots of different typologies or labels that we give designs. The next one talks about how we realize mixed methods integrations. I cannot do this research because no one has integrated the data in a way that I intend to do it. Well, people were feeling fixed by the fact that that they didn't have something that would guide them. And so when you realize integrations, what you often want to do is you want to be able to execute these research procedures in a way that is adapting to the changing conditions. And interestingly enough, we sometimes see descriptions in research that talks about having adapted. But I can tell you that much more adaptations happen in procedures that is not reported in research. And so one of the dilemmas is, how do people who are starting out in mixed methods or even veteran mixed methods respond with agility to changing conditions, given the unpredictability of the dynamic influences that surround their research? And finally, I cannot do this research because I do not yet know what the outcomes might be. Well, this is going to be natural in complexity, but yet in mixed methods, we feel like we should know what we're getting to. And so one of the tasks is for researchers to represent enough information so that we can have confidence. So your validation processes, you want to be able to see the joint display. You want to be able to read about how the interpretations were made. What was the integrated evidence that you're going to underpin the study's implications? Well, one of the dilemmas that's posed is actually creating conditions for interactions, because perhaps we don't yet have the name of a mixed integration that's actually going to help you get to what you want to do. And so you're having to come up with or to justify how you're going about this. So those are patterns that I saw a lot of. And so what we want to do here then is to take a quick look then at some of the take-home messages from these dilemmas, is that too often researchers attempted to reduce, control, or simply ignore the effects of complexity, rather than revisiting these underlying assumptions and adapting our approaches to mixed methods research. And among the ways that we might want to do this is that we see a misfit with the traditional approaches with complex conditions, but we don't know how to go about it in a different way, because we don't see a lot of evidence about that. Now, what's wonderful about this, in the last few years, we've seen calls in mixed methods research of new ways of tackling complex problems. So for example, Donna Mertens in 2015 talked about the fact that business as usual will not lead to effective use of research to address wicked problems. These are the problems which I call complex problems, for which time for solutions is simply running out. And then in the task force, Mertens and colleagues described the future of mixed methods research in their reports to the MMIRA Association and as kaleidoscopic, with its seemingly unpredictable patterns full of rich possibilities for diversity and potential to provide opportunities to see things that have not yet been seen. So there is lots of potential, but yet how do we actually get there? Well, there are opportunities for mixed methods research, and what I've looked at is gone back to the complexity science. So I come from, my first degree was in biology and in chemistry. And so what was fun for me during my doctoral program is I had gone back into some of the original sources of complexity science. And it's taken me a few years to kind of be able to sift and sort through different things and actually be able to make sense of this. So what you see in the first column in this figure is these complexity science principles. And so Lewin in 1999 talks about these four complexity science principles. Then in the middle column, we're going to talk about these assumptions that this complexity lens gives us. And that in the final one, which I hope you can see okay, is this idea about opportunities for mixed methods researchers. So let's take them one at a time. The first one. As a researcher, you may have observed surprisingly sizable effects from what was initially perceived as an insignificant influence during a study, and struggled to make sense, as I certainly have, about how to recognize such processes earlier. An illustrative example from my own research experience involved one person on a research team challenging the members to think beyond what we knew was possible outcomes during the planning stage of a project. This unique perspective shifted some decisions about how we collected data and opened up new opportunities during the analysis that we could not have imagined. In retrospect, I had erroneously anticipated that the contribution of the research by this person would be small. In the end, their influence on our mixed methods insights had been large. Since then, similar experiences have reminded me of the need to assume non-linear and uncertain mixed methods research outcomes. As I've searched for research possibilities that are not yet known, I've embraced one of the key characteristics of complex adaptive systems. And this is this first principle, that small changes can lead to large effects. Indeed, nonlinear relationships are known to be distinctive, and changes are disproportionate between source and consequence. Thus, in order for us to do this then, this nonlinear and uncertain outcomes then, that mixed methods researchers are said to develop greater comfort with tackling complex mixed methods research problems because we have an increased understanding that from the edge of chaos and the unknown comes new possibilities for innovations. We are beginning to see evidence in published accounts that researchers perceive mixed methods as uniquely positioned to address complex research problems where the outcomes are nonlinear and uncertain. And sometimes these authors present logical lines of arguments that undertaking these studies will contribute to tackling larger societal issues, even though the specific study outcomes are not yet certain. So I think that that's actually a very exciting place, and that talks about that first principle. The second principle we're going to talk about is the global perspectives flow from the aggregate behavior of individuals. So that sounds very, very wordy, so let me talk a little bit about what that actually means. As a researcher, you might realize that the capacity that more than one research member, as part of a team, can generate outcomes that have greater than the sum of the individual contributions. You may also have struggled, as I have, to make sense of how to optimize such individual and team potential. An illustrative example from my own research experiences involved a team who developed the capacity to integrate their contributions following a period of conflict in ideas and negotiation of roles. Their collaborative work, drawing on the unique expertise and experiences, generated understandings that I genuinely believe would not have been otherwise accessible. In retrospect, I had mistakenly interpreted the conflict and negotiation stage as negative. I had not anticipated the need for members to manage their own team development. Since then, similar experiences have reminded me of the need to create conditions for self-organization, which is also known as emergence, that describe the contributions of members and teams to accommodate things that they collectively or integratively come together and do. Indeed, emergence means the properties of the whole cannot be accounted for by its components, that the sum of things is greater than what they could have done alone. As I engage members in interactions that are integrative, which is beyond the addition, the simple sum of things, I have incorporated one of the key characteristics of complex adaptive systems. This is that the source of emergence is the interaction to develop greater capacity, that the interaction among agents who mutually affect one another. Thus, researchers are said to develop greater capacity for emergence because of the increased understanding that from the development of mutual relations comes new possibilities for innovations. We are beginning to see evidence in published accounts of concerted development of mixed methods research teams involving this integration, creating conditions of emergence. In these studies, the authors present evidence focused on the development of diverse research teams, and sometimes often bringing together people who they don't quite know how they're going to contribute, but that they know that bringing people together creates different kinds of conditions. They may not, and so then we'll go on to the third one, which is the slight differences in initial conditions can produce very different outcomes. As a researcher, you may have experienced unusual results from what was initially perceived as similar research conditions, and struggled, as I have, about how to distinguish interrelated contexts. An illustrative example from my own research experience involved the comparison of two sample populations in an intervention study where the differing results could not have accounted for by the intervention. This finding led me to reconsider how we developed our initial understandings of research conditions. In retrospect, I had not taken into account the dynamic influences, including personal influences. And since then, similar experiences have reminded me of the need to assume unpredictable and varying mixed methods research contexts. As I have extended my understandings of the boundaries surrounding mixed methods research, I've come to appreciate one of the key characteristics of complex adaptive systems. That is, greater diversity of agents in a system leads to richer emergent patterns. So this means that I want to bring together people who have different ideas, because the more diverse folks are, to a certain extent, then we actually might be able to more easily contribute something that we couldn't have individually. And we're beginning to see evidence in published account where researchers are adopting the system perspective, and they're actually describing in greater detail the backgrounds of folks who are in their research teams. And that, I think that's actually very exciting. So you can start to see what people bring. The last principle is complex systems assimilate to the environmental interactions. And so let's talk a little bit about that. As a researcher, you may have seen how adaptations have occurred in response to dynamic influences and struggle to make sense of, as I have, how I could predict such occurrences. An illustrative example from my own research experience involves a gatekeeper to research site who, as a site was about to begin, blocked access to the site in response to a policy shift in government. In retrospect, I'd incorrectly assumed that the research would be buffered from these societal level influences and had not anticipated the need to attend to these influences. Since then, similar experiences have reminded me of the need to assume the need for responsive designs and agile procedures. As I have accommodated these dynamic influences, I've adapted to one of the key characteristics of complex adaptive systems, which is emergence is certain, but there is no certainty about what it will be. Thus, researchers are said to develop more appropriate mixed methods research procedures because of their increased understanding that from assimilation comes new possibilities for innovations. We're beginning to see evidence in published accounts, although infrequent, of researchers adapting their procedures in response to emerging understandings of study environments, and that and making their and authors providing a rationale for why they've actually adapted their initial designs and procedures. And I hope we start to see more of this. I think these more authentic accounts of how research actually unfolds is actually super important. So we do have several opportunities then for researchers. So a complexity perspective recognizes that research conditions calls into account five traditional mainstays of our practices right now. So what people often tell you is that you need to identify your purpose for integration upfront. And so rather than having to identify it, why can't we frame the study's mixing purpose is about the innovation need? So let's say the innovation need is for different types of insights, or for a new type of design, or for doing research in that will contribute to a pressing issue. So that's what the innovation need is. Why do we need to have to say it's for explaining, or for convergence, or it's for some of the typologies of purposes in which we currently talk about? The stability of the research context can be assumed. So what I propose instead is that we diagnose the study's interrelated context using a system perspective. Why don't we try to describe it and understand it rather than, and then assume and also describe the areas in which are changing, as opposed to just assuming that it's stable. That the expertise needed for the sites, for the insights, can be predetermined. Why can't we have a more fluid approach to our research teams? And so why can't we develop the study's emergence capacity as we go along and bring people in as we need to? And then we also bring them together to do more integrative interactions rather than just bringing them together for more collective work. Next one is designs for guiding the procedures can be fixed. And so I think we need to move beyond the idea that we can assume that the design will unfold as we initially thought it would. Instead, let's describe the study's agility and its ability to adapt to its changing environment. And last but not least, about the findings underpinning the insights can be anticipated. Why don't we instead generate the study's mixed methods insights using responsive validation? So as long as we can provide validation evidence, we don't need to know where we're going. We just have to provide that evidence as we go along. So by responding appropriately, innovations in mixed methods practices are likely. And so by assessing the complexity of problems, we can recognize innovation as a mixed methods purpose and thus a desirable study outcome, even if we don't know what the exact outcome is going to be. If we can assess the complexity of the systems, we can promote the diagnosis of these parts that are going to be more dynamic and then monitor them for their changes. If we can assess the complexity of mixed methods research members, we can access the necessary expertise as we go and develop the integrative capacity as we need to. If we can access the complexity of the mixed methods procedures, we can support this responsiveness to conditions and thinking beyond our existing mixed methods research divines. And finally, if we can access the complexity of integrations, we can represent the integrated findings and embed the validation processes for mixed insights as we go along. So let's take a moment now and check in. Let's revisit the study that you have undertaken or are interested in undertaking that you had a moment to describe at the beginning of the webinar. Let's now see, how might you choose to see the conditions of complexity for the research? Is there anything that has shifted in terms of how you might want to frame the research purpose, how you might want to describe the context, bring together the contributors, plan for the procedures, and anticipate the outcomes? Again, remembering that the ability and how you recognize complexity does rest with you. So the key takeaway messages from this webinar is this idea about paying attention and responding to these varying conditions of complexity. Assess the source of complexity ahead of time and monitor as things unfold in your study. The ability to transform is a valued practice, and that often innovations that can that happen out of this can actually move disciplines forward. And researchers who attend to changing conditions are better positioned for adapting and for not coming up to dilemmas that actually stop the research. So just before we get to questions, I want to spend the last couple of minutes just talking more in generally about mixed methods research. And part of that is because I want to encourage you that, you know, consider what is on your mixed methods research bucket list. And so rather than talking about before I die, that's what many lists do, but let's talk about a different goal. Before you graduate, before you get tenure, before you reach 5 years, before you, whatever works for you, I'd like you to consider and doing any of these things. Have you yet had the chance to teach a course, a workshop, a conference, a chapter, an affiliate? Are you a member of the Mixed Methods International Research Association? Come and meet your mentors. Come and meet others who think similarly or differently than you. Also, have a look at this. Have you published a mixed methods paper? What do you want to do? Do you want to host a webinar like this? So if you're interested, go to the Mixed Methods International Research Association website. It's mmira.org. And you can actually, there is a contact for who you can contact if you want to do a webinar. We want webinars to come from people, not only experts, but also people who maybe you want to partner up with somebody and give a webinar. And so I hope that what you'll do is you'll consider doing something and being part of the Mixed Methods global movement. This past year, the Mixed Methods International Research Association, we had regional conferences in Jamaica, in the US, in Indonesia, in South Africa, and Japan. And next year, we are hosting our third global conference. So you can find out more information about MMIRA at this website. We're constantly adapting to changing needs. If you're interested, we have our third global conference in August of next year, and you are not too late. If you can see, the proposals are due December 31st, and I'd really like to encourage you to do something. There is these two flyers are available in these slides as well as on our Mixed Methods website. So please do consider coming to do that. I've given you a few useful references. This is a nice reference if you're right now developing a mixed methods proposal. This is a great series. This is a mixed methods series that is done by Sage Publications. And the idea is to keep the books small and inexpensive. This is a complexity book that I've been really influenced by. This is one of the ones that we talked about, Donna Merton's. This is the report, and then Vicky Plano Clark and Natalia Ivanikova have a great mixed methods research guide. And I apologize that on this version of the slides in this PC, that things got a little bit cut off. So Yvette, shall I pass it back over to you?
Perfect. Thank you, Cheryl, for that wonderful presentation. Yeah, so the slides will be available on the IIQM website, and they won't have anything cut off on the bottom, so you guys can go check those out. We'll now open the floor to any questions. So if you raise your hand, if you have a microphone, I can give you permission and you can tell us where you're from and ask your question. Alternatively, you can just write your questions below in the chat and we can read those up. While we're waiting for people to send in some questions, I'll just let everyone know that you can go check out the IAQM website, IAQM.ualberta.ca. We've got our first Qual World Interactive Virtual Conference coming up Wednesday, November 29th. So it's 1 day interactive conference. Everything's online. And we've got four great keynote speakers, Trish Greenhaw, Martin Hammersley, Amanda Kenny, and Babette Babish. So you guys can go check that out. Okay, so we've got a raised hand here. Vimala, I'll give you the microphone and then you can ask your question. Vimala, you can go ahead and ask your question. Might not actually have a microphone. In that case, you can just write your question in the chat below, and then we can read out your question.
Oh, great. So there is a question at the bottom here. Shall I take this?
Sure, go ahead.
So which are the main authors you are following for complexity theory? Well, it's a great question. And so I have several people that I have different... I have to be careful that sometimes I get really into kind of the complexity world in terms of, but I really like Lewin. I also get into Ralph Stacey in the organizational development. I'm also influenced by some of the work in program evaluation around Glenda Yeoyang as well. And so I've read all of the different you know, books that are a little bit more in the science world, and really enjoyed that background. But I find there is also a couple of other ones. Bryce has a nice one in the social sciences, BRYCE. And so those are some of the people that I am focused. There's also some other people doing some great work, even within mixed methods research. So Donna Mertens has done some writing, not specifically on complexity theory, but talking about wicked problems. Cooperman had a response around complexity theory in the Journal of Mixed Methods Research. And so Emma Richards, Up Richards, does some work out of the UK. So there's lots of people doing interesting work. And so Vimela has a comment here. Is, are you considering what has been considered as wicked as complex with a different view? Yes. And so very interesting that I have to admit that I kind of liked the word wicked problems, because it does convey to me a sense that that they're interrelated and there's something going on, almost like a vortex, right? But interestingly enough, when I had some peer reviews done, people commented to me that they thought wicked had a negative connotation to it. And that was something that I certainly wanted to stay away from. So I did go back to complex. The problem with complex is that it is, as many of us know, kind of overused. But I do think, I think I've come back and I've made peace with it, that if we're going to talk about complexity, let's talk about complex. Alice has a question. I'm doing a PhD research in economics, which you may know that economics is dominated heavily by quantitative method. Do you have any advice for me? Well, certainly. And there's always good advice. So strangely enough, I don't always talk too much about this, but I came from the biological sciences. And in all my undergraduate and my master's training, I never really heard too much about qualitative research. And so I'm very much steeped in the quantitative. And it wasn't until I was a practicing teacher that I really began to question the limitations of what numbers can tell us, and the have to fit into a certain predetermined box, you know. And that's what the numbers and quantitative research often make us do. I ended up doing a completely qualitative dissertation, so it was a total change for me. Even though I did want to do a mixed method study, the question I needed to ask just wasn't appropriate for mixed methods. So I think if you come back to it, and that the question that you want to do is mixed methods, which it obviously sounds like it is for you, that the biggest advice I would say is find some champions and folks that can help you navigate the mixed methods literature and guide you through a very quantitative field. It's been quite interesting for me because a number of my colleagues who 5 years ago said that they would never do mixed methods are now beginning to, you know, almost see the value in it. And I have to say, that the quantitative researchers that I come across tend to be fairly open to mixed methods research these days. I think it's established enough. So that's a great, great question. I think the advantages, as you know, doing a PhD is that you need to make a contribution to the literature, and it might be even easier for you to do that, given if you're going to do that. And yes, so the presentation will be available online, and the slides I've already, yep, you've got that, Yvette. What is my opinion on Crespel's work in mixed methods? Well, as you know, John and I have had a long and very fruitful relationship. I think John has done more for the field of mixed methods research in terms of making it accessible. He's a brilliant writer. And as I mentioned, I had the chance to work with him on the fourth edition of his qualitative book. I've just recently gotten his and Vicky's new book, and I use that book in my doctoral class. It is the best book in terms of laying out, in my opinion, for beginning folks. But what we're seeing is that where there's a real thirst right now is in actually more intermediate and advanced resources. And we see that. So Pat Baisley just published a book focused on integration and with Sage Publications. Elizabeth Creamer has just done a book this year on integrated mixed methods, so making sure the integration is kind of key. And so I think everybody's kind of, focusing on kind of, beginner, intermediate, and I think we're going to kind of get into that. People know a lot now about how to get started, but then what I think we need more resources and guidance in is actually how to work through the dilemmas when we encounter them. And so it does remind me that I think what happens with mixed methods is that we had these designs that were really good at getting us started, but I think we're now encountering limitations with those designs. And so I look forward to seeing how it, I don't want us to get stifled in our creativity and in how we go forward from here. And so, next question is, what would you recommend to those of us interested in the intersection of mixed methods with other approaches in terms of complexities and potential challenges? Well, go for it. I say there is so much for us to learn as a field from people who are at the intersection of what we know and what we don't know is yet possible. And so, I think by beginning to tackle some of the big problems, we're going to get closer to being able to have a more fruitful understanding of the complexities of some of these big problems. It's going to take time, though, and the one thing that we all have to be patient about is that we're not going to, solve the world's problems overnight, but that we need to chip away at it. And I think together, by people working on different parts of it, together, we can get farther. But I do think it takes a little bit of risk taking. It takes some innovative thinking. It takes some different ways of battling our assumptions, I think. It's a great question too. As you can tell, I don't have all the answers. But like I said, these are the things that have been occupying my brain, and they've been swishing around long enough that I'm ready to now talk about them and put the ideas out. But that I recognize that I hope what happens is people take some of my ideas and either refute them or build on them. This is how we all move the field forward.
Thank you very much, Cheryl. So if there are any more questions out there, feel free to write them below or you can raise your hand. We do still have time left.
I look forward to seeing hopefully many of you at the conference this next year or at AERA. There's a great TIG just come from the American Evaluation Association that has a great, oh, sorry, the AERA SIG and the AEA TIG. So you can find your communities of mixed methods researchers within your own disciplines. And there are lots of great things happening out there and lots of interesting people. And so the biggest thing is to get out there, talk with other people, come to these webinars. And begin to contribute as well. Don't just be on the listening end, but actually get involved. When teaching methodology, do we have to go first on the qualitative and quantitative? That is a great question. And so interestingly, I'm just going to reteach in the winter the introduction to our introductory to research educational research designs. And I am actually going to be introducing quant, qual, and mixed all at the same time. So as we go through, we're going to talk about the problems that are appropriate for each one. We're going to talk about how to write questions. We're going to talk about designs, analysis. And so there has been a lot of literature that talks about doing that, and that early exposure is really helpful to folks so that they see mixed methods as being a possibility. One of the things that I find a lot right now is that I'm sitting on a lot of doctoral committees or as an external or examining committee member, and that the mixed method studies are just simply huge. And so part of what I'm grappling with is how do we do a reasonable, mixed methods research for a dissertation. I have had master's students do mixed methods theses at that, but it's certainly not easy. And so I think that you can introduce them all at the same time, and that's what I'm kind of moving towards doing. When you talked about viewing team contributions to solving, can you expand? Sure. So part of the team idea is that many of our established practices talk about people coming together to contribute, kind of, different aspects. That was kind of the first, kind of phase of teams. The second phase talked about that rather than just having people kind of do pieces of the mixed method study, that you do need people to be involved in kind of all of it so that they understand and that they gain their own capacity for mixed methods research. Well, I think we're into a third stage of kind of team development when we want to go tackle these bigger problems, these more complex problems, because I think it actually is the idea that we can't predetermine everybody. And so we actually have to kind of see that we may have to bring people in on board according to the research team on a needed basis, and that we actually need to integrate folks even more than having them simply work together. But we actually have to really have a core group of people who are working together in and are all in to some of these kind of big problems if we actually are going to come up with something that is beyond simply adding everybody's contribution. And how do you handle the conflict of ideas and understanding in that team? That is a brilliant question. And that is one of the things that I'm currently grappling with. And in my work, I'm starting to see almost like, and I'm writing about this now, about almost like a development of team, where I think all teams have to go through conflict and resolve in order to kind of gain that trust and confidence. It comes down to you need the right people at the right place at the right time. And getting those conditions just right is really difficult. But I think part of it is that for the most part, my mixed methods teams are now comprised of people that I have worked with and that I've almost vetted a little bit about, are they going to be open and willing and able to interact with each other in a respectful manner and understand that we all have, can learn from each other. So having really good skills at conflict resolution as, you know, the person who's bringing them together is a really good one as well.
Okay, so you still got a couple minutes left. There's a couple people typing. Any more questions? So just to remind everyone that this is our last session for 2017. We'll hopefully be back, I believe, January 2018 with a new schedule. So you can check out the IAQM website, iaqm.ualberta.ca, for more information for next year's webinar series. As well, the Qualitative Methods Conference taking place in Banff in May 2018. Abstract submission is open until November 30th, and registration for the conference will open in the first week of December. We'll have two workshop days taking place before the conference, and in fact, Cheryl will be there teaching mixed methods, so hopefully we'll see some of you out there for that.
Yeah, I just want to say thank you to everybody. Thank you, Yvette, for your time. Thank you to everybody for your questions and for, you know, really being open to complexity. It's not an easy construct to talk about, but I think it's the next kind of, you know, frontier of mixed methods.
So I think there are no other questions. Then we'll end there for the day. Cheryl, thank you so much for that wonderful presentation, all the knowledge that you've shared with everyone. Any final words?
Just that, you know, if I can be of help, drop me a note. I'm happy to do that. And thanks again.
Great. Take care, everyone. Thank you for attending. Have a good day.
Bye.